Today's message is all about our responsibility as not only Americans, but as the Christian American. Because we was founded on Christian beliefs by Christians, on fundamental biblical doctrine. Everything that America stands on and is guided by can go right back to the Word of God. So today I'm preaching, and yes, I'm preaching about my thumb. What's left of it. On August the 15th, I got up early, went in there and kicked Ty's door open. It's about 5:30. I said, hit the floor, let's go. I go back and go to getting dressed, and I start to leave the house. And I'm leaving out of my room, and my wife is quiet, and she's asleep, and I have been so quiet because that's the kind of man I am. I don't disrupt her rest, you know. I open the door, listen, crack, and she goes, you going to pen cows? I said, yeah. Are y'all taking horses? I said, yeah. And I'm keeping walking, and as the door's shutting, you know what I hear her say? That ain't never good. So when I got to the back door, I said, shut up, woman. You know, I'm not stupid. At 6 in the morning, I don't feel like fighting. We load up, and we head out there, and I meet Mark Hunt and a few guys to pen this set of cows. I got a truck coming. They're shipping a load of yearlings back to the panhandle. And you know, it's still hot. August the 15th, I want to get it done early. I don't want to stress them cattle. We get paid by the gang. So the longer in the day, the hotter they get, the more weight they lose, the less money we make. You with me? So we want to get this done. We want to get it done fast. I guarantee by 7 o'clock, we have 61 of the 68 in the pen. I mean, 61 of the 69 in the pen. And 8 of them are ignorant. I'm talking about ignorant. And they going in 8 different directions. We put the dogs on them and bay them up, and then we just barely start to move them. There they'd go, 8 different directions. I mean, it was not good. By 8 o'clock, by 8:30, Mark was praying more than me. He was like, just calm down. I'm so dadgum mad. Now I got 61 head of cattle standing in the pen that are submissive and quiet and calm and peaceful, and it's hot and they can't drink water. So what are they doing? Losing weight. Even though they done what they should do, even though they done what I needed them to do, even though they done what the right thing to do, they're standing in the pen suffering because of why? The 8 idiots that's out there got all our attention, all our effort, and by now I am mad. I'm not frustrated no more. I'm mad. I hollered at Mr. Buck. Mr. Buck was a horseback. And I said, just get off your horse and get in that pickup. And I built the loop, and I rolled across the pasture, and I peeled that little heifer off that fence. And I mean, old sister put me right on top of her, and I stuck it on her and fed too much slack back into my rope, which caused my knot to pop on my saddle horn. But pride is a painful thing, and anger is worse, or maybe it's vice versa. But I wasn't finna let her go. So I just reached and grabbed the rope with my hand, shoved it back over the saddle horn, and I had my thumb on the wrong side of the rope. When we got stopped, I was like this. And she was choking. And there was some gratification in that. You know, I hollered at Mark, and I said, Hunt, you need to get over here and put a rope on her, because I got to go. He lopes up there and ropes her, and as soon as he does, I undo my rope, and I need my rope back. I pitched my rope on the ground, and I loped for the pickup. I'm just headed for the pickup. And I passed Ty. He's on the way, you know. So I told Ty, I said, you stay with Mr. Buck all day. I'll get with you tonight. I get to my pickup, and Damon Bassett's there. I don't know how many of y'all know Damon Bassett. I love Damon. He jumps off his horse, and, you know, he's wound up. And I said, just unhook that trailer where I can go. He said, I'm going to drive you. I said, just unhook that trailer where I can go. I unloosen the saddle on my horse and tired of the trailer, and I walk over there, and he said, No. Mark told me to drive you. And I said, I don't care what Mark said. Unhook my trailer so I can drive off. And Damon thought, you know, I'm sure he was thinking, this sucker's tough. I couldn't have stood listening to Damon at that moment. He would have talked way too much. You know, he was too excited. I mean, he was way overamped, and it would have been like Ty. I just needed some quiet. So, anyway, as Damon got me unhooked and I got in the pickup, I told Damon, I said, you tell Mark to catch them, Kill them or turn them out. I don't care. I'm done. I'm going to go get this fixed. Next day, I was reading in the Bible, in Zechariah chapter 11, verse 15. Then the Lord said to me, go again and play the part of a worthless shepherd. This illustrates how I will give this nation a shepherd who will not care for those who are dying, nor look after the young, nor heal the injured, nor feed the healthy. Instead, this shepherd will eat the meat of the fattest sheep and tear off their hooves. What sorrow awaits this worthless shepherd who abandons the flock. Now listen to these words. What sorrow awaits this worthless shepherd who abandons the flock. The sword will cut his right arm, or cut his arm, and pierce his right eye. His arm will become useless and his right eye completely blind. I read this the day after I cut my thumb off. Y'all are thinking the same thing I'm thinking. What did I do? Literally, I'm blind in my right eye. The week before, the elders catch me on a Wednesday night and said, look, you're too irritable. You're short-tempered. We don't want to see you for 3 weeks. And now my thumbs, this arm, I can't even zip my pants by myself. I'm 40 years old. You hear me? That makes you feel pretty darn. You hear me? You go to the bathroom and the men's room and you go, shoot. You know what you do? You walk around with your shirt untucked. Yeah. Because you can't do nothing about it. I look like all them other punks. Walk around holding my britches up, one arm. Shoot. Boy. I wrote right here in my Bible on August the 16th of 2012, Lord, are you telling me I'm worthless? I sit here this morning one-eyed, completely blind in my right eye. My right arm is completely worthless. I can't do nothing with it. And my elders have told me I needed to not come to church for 3 weeks. Lord, have I abandoned the flock? Have I neglected your flock? Have I taken advantage of the flock? And you're waking me up, or you're telling me my time is done, I'm worthless. Well, tell you something, that'll make you hit your knees. It'll also make you dig in God's word to find the true answer. Because Satan's telling me, that's you, boy. That's you. You no count, son gone. You know, and I'm going, dang, I didn't know they knew about that. I didn't know they knew I said that when that thumb went flying through the air. I didn't know. All my mistakes, everything's replaying now because I'm like, Lord, I know I fail. I know I fail, and I try hard, but I fail. But am I worthless? I can be a lot of things, guys. A liar I'll never be called, nor worthless, because I will put out all the effort I have. I will give everything I've got, and I'll not lie. And to feel like God's word has been revealed to you that you're worthless will make you hit your knees. And I'm reading and praying. I called the elders and said, we need to work on it. I called John. I called Mark Hunt. I said, now, elders may lie to you because they don't hurt your feelings too much. You know, talking about not lie like lie, but to me, they may say, in fact, Rusty said, just study God's word, calm down. We'll walk through it. It's nothing. Mark scratched his head and he said, sounds just like you. You can't see nothing. You ain't got one heart. Sound like it. In fact, you left me cleaning up that mess. And boy, in my mind, I went, you know what I did? I'm the shepherd of that set of cattle. My job was to tend to them, to make them fatter than they were when I got them, make them healthier than they were when I got them, and that's what I would be paid for if I'd done that for them. And when I drove off, the last thing I said, y'all remember the last thing I said? Catch them, kill them, or turn them out. I don't care. That ain't a very good shepherd. You hear me? That's a worthless shepherd. Hunt said, I better read on that a little while. But that kind of description kind of fits you right now, don't it? For 3 days, me and Mark, I know Mark read on this. I read on this. And I finally backed up to, I'm talking about this is my Bible. It's wrote all over Zechariah 11. I've wore Zechariah 11 out. And I read it and reread it and reread it. And God finally started showing me, he wasn't talking about me. But I went through what I went through, And God revealed to me a truth about our nation. And this is a prophecy that Zechariah brought to the people of Israel. They were in captivity. They were slaves. But Zechariah brought this prophecy. And he preached this prophecy, proclaiming it to that nation. And this prophecy is coming again. This prophecy is being fulfilled in our nation. Because listen, we are a chosen nation. The Israelites were a chosen nation. The more you study the history of America, the more you'll see things that lined up exactly the way the Israelites did it. The same prophecies, the same scriptures read. It just is mind-boggling. We're not taught it. And if we was taught it in 1989, I slept. But I had no idea this. So much of our nation came about straight, just like the Israelite nation. Just like the same things happened and lined up exactly. But I'm going to share with you today, as quick as I can, this prophecy that's coming true today. And I preach this in Maine. And I'm probably going to preach this in Cincinnati, Ohio next week. And I'm probably going to preach it in St. Louis, Missouri at the end of the month. And I'm probably going to preach it as many places as they let me go between now and November. But if you look in verse 4, it says, "This is the Lord my God says, go and care for the flock that is intended for slaughter." Now he's talking about the Israelites when Zechariah is preaching this. He says, "The buyers slaughter their sheep without remorse, and the sellers praise the Lord now that I'm rich. Even the shepherds have no compassion for them. Likewise, I will no longer have pity on the people of this land, says the Lord. I will let them fall into each other's hands and into the hands of their king. They will turn the land into wilderness, and I will not rescue them." Pause. All right. He's talking about the nation that have held his Israelite children captive. They have used them as slaves. The Israelites have been led like a lamb to slaughter. They have been neglected and abused. On my plane ride to Maine, it hit me that America was established by colonials, and the British sent us over here to do one thing: harvest huge timber and a unique rock and send back to the British. They didn't care about us. They didn't care about the people that were coming. They sent the people that established in the harbors of Maine, which is where we just preached at, to cut trees. And they were called hewers. They died. They froze to death. They starved to death. But the country that sent them over here did not care about them. Had no concern for their well-being. All they want to know was our boats loaded back headed this way full of big wood and nice, beautiful granite rock. Y'all with me? That's what we started out as. Same thing with the Israelites. They were in captivity. They were used. They were killed. They were slaves. And God said, "I care for this flock intended to slaughter. The flock that was oppressed, then I took two shepherd staffs, and I named one favor and the other one union, and I got rid of the three evil shepherds in a single month." When God decided to intervene for the Israelites, he said, I will be their shepherd, and I will have two staffs, one to protect them and one my favor upon them and the other one to protect them, to unite them. When the shepherd tended to their sheep, they carried two staffs. One of them was a long one, like you remember seeing Moses carry, the long one with the hook on the end. It was used to bring the sheep back. You know what I'm saying? The sheep go to get drifted astray. He'd reach out there and catch it with that hook and bring it to him. And it was used to clear brush or whatever he needed it to do. And he also carried a club, and it was used to knock whoever out come at him. It was used to kill the lions and the bears. It was his weapon to kill it. So God told, I believe with all my heart, God looked on this nation and seen an oppressed bunch of people that were being used and killed and murdered and maimed. And he put it upon one Indian to go and find this little old colonials and feed them for a winter and teach them how to plant corn. I mean, there's so many things that when you dig into our nation's country, our history, God's the only way that happened. The only way we defeated and won our independence was because God's hand was directly on top of us. We had God's favor. God's favor, that word actually means his grace, which means God's ability, God's power. Keep reading, it says, but I became impatient with these sheep, and they hated me too. When we all know the Israelites, they could never act right very long, right? So remember, and they walked around that mountain in the wilderness for 40 years because they just wouldn't get right. Throughout the Old Testament, they would repent, come to God, wouldn't last long, they'd forget who he was, act like they didn't know him. Give us something. You know, God delivers them, and they said, oh, give us a king we can see. They wanted Saul. They picked Saul over God himself. America's done the same thing. It says, God said, I have become impatient with these sheep, and they hated me. So I told them, I won't be your shepherd any longer. If you die, you die. If you are killed, you are killed. And let those who remain devour each other. Now that's harsh. That's hard words. But they're very true in our nation today. Then I took my staff called favor and I cut it in two, showing that I had revoked the covenant that I had made with all the nations. That was the end of my covenant with them. The suffering flock was watching me. Listen now, the suffering flock was watching me, and they knew that the Lord was speaking through my actions. When I had all them cattle in the pen, and we was out there catching and chasing the rest of them, the 61 was standing in that pen, losing weight, getting thirsty, being hot, and suffering. You with me? And the 8 idiots was in control. Believe whether I want to admit it or not, and then I was plumb out of the picture. I'm sitting in the emergency room. Ty calls me about 6:30 that evening. Of course, he's a loving, kind, caring kid. He says, "Well, Dad, we got one more of them caught. 4 of them went through a fence. 1 of them we ain't seen, but ain't nothing dead. We'll catch them tomorrow." I said, okay, fine. The next day, Levi and them went and caught, I think, 3 or 4. Long story short, out of the 8, 1's crippled, 1's dead, 1 can't be found. 5 been caught. 61 probably lose 50 pounds standing inside the heat, burning up 8 hours watching all this ignorance take place. Sounds like America. The 61 head is the church, guys. Church stands in the pen, and we look outside suffering and hating what's happening to our country, and the 8 on the outside, the radicals, the idiots. Now listen, I'm not talking about either side, left wing, right wing, or I'm talking both of them. The idiots that are far left and the idiots that are far right, they're the ones that's jerking the chains of our country while we sit in the pen and suffer. And suffer. Let me give you a couple more statistics. There are, in 2006, 350,000 religious congregations in the United States. I didn't say 350,000 people, 350,000 religious congregations, groups in the United States. 314,000 of them are Christian and Protestant. 24,000 are Catholic or Orthodox denominations, churches. And 12,000 are non-Christian. Religious groups, cults, religious groups that are not based of Christ. 12,000. You tell me how in the world 314,000 religious congregations, and we got abortion legal in America. We can't have God in school. We can't say God in public. We can't pray. We can't put baby Jesus up at Christmas time. We have to have holly season instead of Christmas. You tell me we ain't standing in a pen suffering. 314,000. I said, well, as the Lord's revealing this to me, I'm on the plane with Christy and I'm writing this down on a napkin because I don't have nothing else to write on. I tried to write on the barf bag and they're all real slick. You can't write on a barf bag. I guess they don't want that stuff clinging to the sides. I never thought about that. Anyway, just so you know, keep a napkin on you. You can't write on them. But I'm writing these little thoughts down as they come to me. And the next scripture, I got my Bible, I'm reading them. And then Zechariah, and I said to them, if you like, give me my wages, whatever I am worth, but only if you want to. So they counted out for my wages 30 pieces of silver. And the Lord said to me, throw it into the potter. This magnificent sum at which they value you, So I took the 30 coins and I threw them into the potter, threw them to the potter in the temple of the Lord. Now remember, 30 coins, 30 pieces of silver was the same thing Judas was paid for betraying Jesus. So prophecy was this is a prophecy for them, but it's also, I mean, it's a prophecy that Jesus Christ would fulfill. You following me? It's also a prophecy that needs to be fulfilled today. Do you know why? Do you know why preachers don't preach and tell their congregations, you better dadgum get out there and vote? Do you know why preachers don't preach and tell them the truth about the condition of our country and about the politicians that we have running and the offices that we have? Do you know why we don't stand up here and say, now listen, today, in 2 weeks, you're going to vote for the county dog catcher, and I want you to know, this are the stats and the truths about candidate A and about candidate B. Because candidate A, he's been serving and grew up in our county. He loves the Lord. I personally know him, and I trust this man, and he could watch over my kids. Now, candidate B, he just moved in here from out of state, and he's already been caught doing this. And you know why preachers don't do that? Because we're chickens. We're scared to stand up here and tell you the truth about the people that we know about. Listen, we're the shepherds of this flock. One staff is to protect and care for you. The other one is to whoop the snot out of the attacks and comes at us. And you don't get paid very well for telling the truth. I promise you, if we ever passed the hat today, there'd be less money than any other time. Because y'all don't want to hear what I'm talking about. People don't want to hear about politics at church. I have been told, I don't want to come to church. I don't hear politics at church. That's why your country's in such a wreck. Take God out. See how long it lasts. Now listen, I ain't going to tell you how to vote. That's against the law. If you don't vote by this word, you ain't worth your salt. If you don't read this word and you don't pray and say, Lord, I got an important decision to make. I got to put down who I believe should be the leader of our country, the leader of my county. County rep, county dog catcher. I don't. If it's an elected position, we need to pray about it. And we need to seek godly counsel about it. Some of you ain't real smart. I'm not. So you know what I've learned to do? I call somebody. You're pretty smart. You've been around. You got gray hair. You done been through the Carter, the Reagan, the Bush, and the, you hear me? Tell me, in the Clinton, Lord have mercy. What we? So, I mean, I get some advice. You kids turning 18, 19, 20 years old, don't go up there and vote from the stupid idiot box says and I had the best ad and he's friends with the Geico, so let's vote for him. Don't be doing that. Find out something. Learn something. It's not your fault. Our stupid school districts don't teach y'all about American history. They just teach you what they want you to know. It's not your fault. And it's not the teacher's fault. You know what? You know whose fault it is? It's the fact that we quit voting. And we let whoever get in office. And they said, do y'all know that the majority of the textbooks are written by the Islamic Brotherhood? Can you believe that? Not in the state of Texas. We will stand up every now and then and say, not in our state. But across the nation, the books that are issued to our public schools are built and written by companies that are owned by the Islamic Brotherhood. Yeah. Anyway, let's stay. I'm in a whole nother book. Lord have mercy. Zechariah 11. Then I took my other staff, Union, and I cut it in two, showing that the bond of unity between Judah and Israel had been broken. Now listen, this nation Israel had entered into a covenant with God. But there's two different covenants you enter into with God. There's the conditional and the unconditional. And I want you to understand, Acts 2:21, which is our founding scripture, says, whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Period. That is an unconditional covenant. It also says that whoever that the Lord, that God puts in the hand of Jesus, will never be plucked out. That's an unconditional covenant. Romans 8:38 says, I am convinced that nothing, life, nor death, nor demon, nor evil, nor nothing, not nothing ever created, not nothing on heaven or below, not nothing can separate us from the love of God that's found through Jesus Christ our Lord. That's an unconditional covenant. You hear me? But Romans 8:28 maybe it is. I'm gambling now. You don't have to try. Don't. I'm going to mess you up. And you're going to make me look stupid. There's a scripture that says, all things work together for the good to those that love the Lord and called according to his purpose. That's a conditional covenant. You want it all to work out? Do his will. Live called according to his purpose. You don't do his will, guess what ain't going to happen? It ain't going to all work out. That's the difference. You with me? You following me? So listen, God entered into a conditional covenant with the nation of Israel. Now flip to Deuteronomy 28. I'm going to let him do it because I'm tired of trying to flip. Deuteronomy 28, I want you to know, this is a little bit of American history. The very first president of the United States' name was George Washington. In New York City, which was the capital of our nation at the time, he accepts the office of presidency of the United States of America. You with me? He opens his Bible to Deuteronomy 28, and he reads these exact words. If you fully obey the Lord your God and carefully keep all his commands that I am giving you today, the Lord your God will set you high above all the nations of the world. You will experience all these blessings if you obey the Lord your God. Your towns and your fields will be blessed. Your children, your crops will be blessed. Offspring of your herds and flocks will be blessed. Your fruit baskets, your breadboards will be blessed. Wherever you go and whatever you do, you will be blessed. The Lord will conquer your enemies when they attack you. They will attack you from one direction, but they will be scattered from you in seven. Our nation was founded, and the first president elected by our nation, put into the office of president of these United States, read those words, the very first speech he ever gave as a president. Do you know what he did for this nation? He entered into a conditional covenant with God. God will always do his part. The beginning of that says, if you obey. The very first scripture, Deuteronomy 28, if you fully obey the Lord your God carefully, God will always do his part. If this country would do its part, God will still do his part. We've quit. But when the founder of our, when the first president stood on the inauguration day with his hand on God's word and made that promise and made that oath, as the president of our country, he led us, he brought us, he guided us, he moved us into a conditional covenant with God because of the office that he held. That office as president of these United States is the leader of this country. It's the head of this country. It's the shepherd of this country. You know, I'm not personal friends with Rick Perry, but he speaks at these deals that I'm privileged to go and speak at. And me and Christy, we actually got to go to his inauguration last year. And at his inauguration, after he prayed and had four other people pray at a church on inauguration day, the church that he attends on Sunday mornings, he stood up and he said, guys, when I was 26 or 8, he'd been in the Army, done went to school, but he went in the Air Force, I believe. And when he came out, he didn't have a clue what to do with himself. He couldn't find a job, didn't know what he was supposed to do. He was a late 20-year-old man, single, without a vision, without a clue. He went to his mom and daddy's house. He said, and there I was in my bedroom, is it my kid room. Now, that's humbling. I ain't never done it, but that's got to be humbling. And he said, I began to pray, and God called me to be a pastor. He said, God called me to be a minister and a pastor for his people. He said, and today I'm still just a pastor and a shepherd. I had no idea he would give me the congregation of Texas, but I accept it willingly. I stand before you and say, Governor Perry is a Christian man. I know he ain't always right. I know he can say things and you go, what the heck was that? I know he's a Christian. And I know as a shepherd of our nation, by the fruits and by what I've seen, and don't misunderstand me, and please don't misquote me. The Lord said to me, go again and play the part of a worthless shepherd. This illustrates how I will give this nation a shepherd who will not care for those who are dying, nor look after the young, nor heal the injured, nor feed the healthy. Instead, this shepherd will eat the meat of the fattest sheep and tear off their hooves. Well, I'm going to tell you something. There's people in our American country that have worked hard to gather up what they got. They've sacrificed for generations to build ranches, to build businesses, to build better lives for their families, to give more, to leave something behind for their family. They sacrificed and ate noodles when they were young so that when they got older, they could eat a steak. Well, we got a shepherd right now, and that's somebody that wants to take what we've worked hard for and give it to people that don't work. And he wants to cripple our country. And you know what? I know Obama has, Mr. President Obama has told the truth 2 times. He said he believed he was appointed by God to become president of these United States. And I believe he's right. Because he had to fulfill Zechariah 11. Because we won't wake up. We're hard-headed. We won't repent and turn back to God. We have yet to turn back. Now it's beginning. Now listen, I got hope because I see it happening. And I see it happen. And when I said what I said here a while ago, when I said it in Maine, they got up. They was like, yeah, worthless son of a gun. They understood that part of my whole deal. It's happening across our country, and I'm not bashing anybody. I'm telling you the truth. I'm telling you the truth. Our nation is crippled, guys. Our nation is in a terrible shape, and it needs a revival. It does not need a stimulus plan. It does not need somebody that understands how to get the work first back and going. It does not need somebody that understands economics and gets money rejuvenated. You know what it needs? This nation was founded on spiritual principles. It needs a spiritual awakening. Is all it needs. If we get woke up spiritually, everything else will line out. Everything else will line out. And I'll tell you something, there's a few pastors that I don't care if I ever get paid. It's not about money to me. I come into this world broken naked. I like being broken naked, and I'll leave here broken naked. Amen. I believe our country's waking up, and I believe it's turning around. And my kids ain't going to inherit no bankrupt, crippled nation. That's not how we are. But I know it's not by my strength, it's by his strength. I know it's not by mine, but by the Lord's. And I know if I fall, it's going to hurt. Why I get down here? Well, I can still fall here on level ground, but I won't have near as far to fall. Here's the last thing I'm closing on. Do you know what I could have done the minute my thumb got ripped off? Do you know what I think, you know what God has shown me I should have done? I should have just looked at Mark and said, turn all them kettle air out of them pens and let me swallow my pride. Call that trucks, tell them not to come, let's regroup. This deal's a train wreck. Shut everything down. The 61 cows that are gentle and know what to do would have walked out of the pen, and they would have walked amongst the 8 that was ignorant, and they'd have settled the 8 down. And when we went at them again, they'd all still be fat. There wouldn't be one dead, one crippled, and one we can't find. I'd still not have a thumb, but my cattle would be better. Listen, being a worthless shepherd don't mean you won't get hurt. Don't mean you won't suffer. It means your flock won't suffer. Me losing a thumb is not no major thing. It's nothing. I didn't need it and couldn't pick nothing with it anyway. So it's not like it's a, you know, it's not that big a deal. What kills me is we killed one, we crippled one, and can't find one. That's what kills me as a cowboy. is that I rode off and left men trying to pick up my mess while I sat in the air-conditioned emergency room. I mean, that's what hurts me. If I had it all to do over again, looking back, I would have said, whoa, get that rope off that heifer, let her go, go open that gate, and let the rest of them go. Let's just catch our breath and regroup. Listen, guys, the gate's open. The gate's open. You ain't got to stay in your church. You can't. Listen, please send this to 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue. Because they can't do jack squat about what I preach on. They can't. They can't take your 501c3 as a church. You know why? You ain't got to have it. Who cares? It's bull. As a nation, the gate is not shut on Christianity. Christians just got in the pen and wouldn't come back out. We believed it. But I'm telling you, that's over. That's over. I'm telling you, I deal with pastors across this country, and they're all sick of it. They're all tired of being told, stay right behind that pulpit and say what you want to about the church and the Bible. Don't you mention the government and don't get outside your pulpit. That's over. Because if it ain't over, we're the worthless shepherds. And we're going to pray, if you filled out your voter registration cards, y'all need to be getting at your doors. There's going to be folks at them doors, and them ladies is going to be at them tables out there if you need any help getting it sorted out. It's your duty. It's your duty to vote. It's your duty to vote for this country. That's how you get out of the pen. That's how you get back out and settle this country back down, as you cast your votes. It's not just important, it's essential for us to get God back in authority. The Christian got to be heard. You hear me? Chronicles 7 says, if my people who are called by my name would humble themselves and turn from their wicked ways, then I will heal their land. That's a conditional covenant. If you do yours, God will do his. Okay? That's the truth, guys. Here's my closing statement. In each and every one of our lives, there's areas. The Holy Spirit is submission. He's at peace. His will is to bring harmony. And he'll pen real quick. You can put the Holy Spirit in a pen real quick within you. You could say, you know, Holy Spirit, I'll let you out on Sunday morning when I go to church, but on Friday night when I'm getting drunk, I'm going to keep you shut up. I'm going to keep the gate shut. You hear me? If you're here today and you feel like there's a part of you, that ignorant part that wants to get out there on Saturday night and swing on the table, or that ignorant part that's fighting with your wife right now and said them hateful, stupid things that you say, that ignorant part that has you so broke you can't buy groceries, that ignorant part that's run off, and you know what I'm saying? Listen, I can tell you how to settle everything down. Turn the Holy Spirit out. Don't leave him in the pen and let the idiot outside. You hear me? You can do it the way me and Mark did and Levi did. We can go catch one, kill part of it. We can choke him and cripple him. Or you can turn the Holy Spirit loose and let him go settle everything and calm everything down. I want you to turn the Holy Spirit loose here today. Turn him loose within your heart. Turn him loose and let him have control. Turn him loose and say, you know, Lord, you know I'm an idiot. You know I fight, I fuss, I cuss, whatever I'm doing. I struggle in this area, Lord. But I'm asking you, I'm telling you, I'm opening your gate. But you got to come out. You got to let the Holy Spirit out. Amen? Let's pray. Dear Lord, we just come to you. Brian, won't y'all come? Can y'all come play that song, sing that song again, Amy? While I'm praying, they're going to get ready and sing. Does that mess you up too bad? Dear Lord, we thank you so much. We thank you, Lord, for this chance to be here. I thank you, God, that I am born in America. I thank you, Lord, that you've entrusted me to be an American citizen. It's an honor to be an American citizen, Lord. To be a part of a nation that you have blessed far beyond any nation. We are truly a nation set on a hill that the rest of this world looks at and goes, I want to be like America. I want to achieve what America's achieved. I want to accomplish what America accomplished. And Lord, you accomplished so many great things, and you allowed us to be a part of it. We thank you for that. And Lord, I know this church body, we plead with you, please. Lord, give us a chance. Please allow your hand of favor to be upon us just for a little while. Lord, give us a chance to make this a known nation of God. Give us a chance to raise your voice, to get out of the pen, Lord, and go out into our communities and our homes and our country. Lord, please don't remove your hand completely. Lord, please, the conditional covenant that we made with you in the beginning of our country, Lord, we know that you've held up your end of the deal, and we have begun to fail. Lord, I know this nation has said things and has done things and has passed laws that signify and that says we hate you. But Lord, I love you. And I'm pleading with you. Because I know what's going to happen if your hand is gone, Lord. Please don't take your hand off our country. Please, Lord, we plead with you. Lord, I pray for anybody here today that is wore out and they feel like they've just... the Spirit's dead in him, and he's just standing over there in a pen, and he's suffering. And the Holy Spirit that you planted, Lord, he's just, they can't feel him. It's because they got him locked up. And the idiot that's in him is running wild and rampant all over the place and getting them hurt and running them through fences and just tearing everything up. Lord, I pray that they'd not stand another day, but they'd release the Holy Spirit that's within them, Lord. If that's to come down here and let us pray with them, Lord, to just fall on their face before your throne and beg for your forgiveness and ask for your Spirit to be shaken and stirred and awakened within them. I just pray, God, that you'd do so today. And I pray that they'd do their part. I know you'll do yours. I know that if there's anybody here that don't know you as their Lord, you done your part. If they'd just say, I don't know Jesus, but I want him, Lord, it would be done. If they would do their part. Lord, if there's a marriage here that's on the rocks and falling apart and a man's been acting ignorant and a woman's been frustrated and hurting and crying, and Lord, they're just at opposite ends of the world, opposite ends of their, and they're just, Lord, if they'd just do their stinking part and honor what they promised you they'd do, I know you'd do your part and you'd restore them. I pray, God, you just would heal so many that are fighting for their health, and just, Lord, I just pray you comfort those that are in need. In Jesus Christ's name, amen.